1, 2, 3, 4. Well, good evening and welcome once again to our service. We thank you for tuning in. We thank you for those faithful that tune in every week. We're happy to get together and do this. We are all volunteers and we're all here because God's called us to this ministry. And so we pray each week as we prepare our message and as we prepare our songs that what we do here is encouraging to you and uplifting to you and draws you closer to Him. Kathy's going to lead us in an old favorite now.
Thank you.
It's your turn now. Follow Kathy. That's why we praise him. That's the title of my message tonight, and we just sang it together. But, you know, as I was thinking about, we've just come through Passion Week, we've just come through Easter, and the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I really felt like we needed to sing that song together. And I actually want to use the song that we just sang, That's Why We Praise Him, as kind of the backbone of my message here this evening. That's why we praise him. Turn with me, if you have your Bibles, to Psalm 150. Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with sounding of trumpet. Praise him with harp and lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, each week we bring you a worship service, and that's important. It's not just a church service, it's a worship service. We come to worship God. The Bible says over and over again, many times, that we are to praise God verbally, sing, instruments. And what we do here is praise God. We have a worship service, and it's our goal, and it's our hope each week that the worship songs that we pick, whether they're old hymns, whether they're old classic rock rewrites, whether they're contemporary worship songs, that they get into your soul and help you to worship him and to help you to put aside the worries of today and the worries of tomorrow and focus on God and focus on his son and focus on the things that he did. That's why we praise him. If we go down through that song, that's why we praise him. He came to live a perfect life. Now, how hard would it be for somebody to live a perfect life? I know I'm far from that. And yet, Jesus came and lived a perfect life. He was without sin. I don't know too many people in my life that I would consider nearly perfect. The one that comes to mind is my grandfather. My grandfather was a saint as far as I'm concerned. And if it wasn't for my grandfather, number one, I wouldn't be a born-again Christian. And number two, I would have never become a pastor. It was because of him. And all growing up, my whole life, even up until when my grandmother passed away and he came and lived with us, my grandfather was as close to a saint as you could probably find. I never heard him say a bad word. I never heard him say anything against another person. He always had a smile on his face. He was always ready to sit down and listen when you needed him. He was always ready to give you advice if you needed it. He was always ready to share the good news of Jesus Christ with whoever he came in contact with. He used to keep scriptures on little index cards to memorize them in his pocket. And every once in a while throughout the day, he'd pick the card out of his pocket and he would read and try to memorize another verse of scripture. He was the most godly man that I think I've ever known on this earth. And yet, he was still a sinner. He was still not perfect. He still needed someone to come and be a sacrifice. And that's what Jesus came for. He was born to die. First of all, he came to live a perfect life. That has to happen first. God needed a sacrifice. God needed a way for you and I to be able to be one with the Father. And that could never be as long as there was sin in the world. And so the first thing that Jesus did is he came and he lived a perfect life. The second thing is that he came to be the living Word. Our life, the living Word, our life. And if you turn with me in your Bibles to John, let's look at John 1:1. John 1:1. I'm going to read John 1:1 to 5, and then we're going to look at verse 14 as well. John 1. In the beginning was the Word. That was Jesus. In the beginning. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus was God. Jesus is God. Jesus has always been, and Jesus will always be. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. Past, present, and future. In him was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And the darkness never will overcome it. The darkness never will overcome it. We, as born-again Christians, have the light of Jesus living within us through his Spirit. And no matter what happens, no matter what you're facing, no matter what we see going on around us, his light can never be snuffed out by the darkness of this world. Never be snuffed out by the darkness of this world. And then verse 14, and the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Now, if Jesus had not come, if Jesus had not come to be the perfect man without sin, if Jesus had not come to be our Word and our light, things would not be as hopeful as they are right now, no matter what you're going through. Thirdly, he came to die so we could be reconciled. He came to die so we could be reconciled. Up until the point that he came, the priests would go in and they would do a sacrifice for sins, but it was never enough. It was never enough. For us to be able to be one with the Father, for us to be able to go directly to the Father with our concerns, with our prayers, with our requests, there had to be a once and for all sacrifice, and that's what Jesus came to do. He came, he lived, he died, he was crucified, he was dead, and he was buried. But the tomb is empty. He rose. And because he rose from the dead, because he was victorious over death, we also are victorious. We also have a way to the Father. We have been reconciled. Our sins, past, present, and future, have been covered in the blood of Jesus. And lastly, he came to rise to show his power and might. We sang last week, the same power. And that's a wonderful song. I love that song. But it reminds us that the same power that rose Jesus from the grave lives within each and every one of us. If you have come to the place in your life where you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you have the power of Him, the power of His resurrection, the power living within you to overcome any obstacle that you encounter, to overcome any darkness that might be around you, to overcome anything that this world is going to throw at you. You have the power within you because of what Jesus did. He came. He lived a perfect life. He was our light. He lived within each and every one of us. Willingly, he went to the cross. You know, there's an old song, and it kind of reminds me. When Jesus was hanging on that cross, you know, all he had to do was say one word, and the armies of heaven would have come down, and it would have made Rambo look like a chick flick. But he hung there in agony, and he died a criminal's death, so that through his death, through that sacrifice, through the shedding of his blood, you and I are free. We are a free people because Jesus came. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Now let's return to the worship.
2, 3, 4. How many roads must a man
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. And it's all
again, thank you, Lord. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for joining us. We always look forward to meeting with you each week, and as we just sang, our offering of worship to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the gift of music. Thank you for the gift of worship. Father, that we can play our instruments and that we can sing songs of praise to you for the glorious things that you have done. And even for just a little while, we can take our mind off the things that have come and gone the last week and the things that are ahead for the week to come and just rest in the fact that you're in control. Nothing is taking you by surprise and you have a way. We just need to rest and trust in you. And so, Father, we'll continue to seek your guidance and seek your direction in everything that we do. And may everything that we do bring honor and bring glory to your name. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.